All right. Good morning, everybody. How are you doing? My name is Neil McNamara with Grimco. I'm the technician that runs the demo center here that we assembled here in Chicago. With me to my right is Ramon with ESKO. He's going to help us with this demonstration this morning. So thanks for attending. This is the fourth virtual event that Grimco has brought to everybody. I hope we're providing some valuable content to help you guys make decisions in equipment purchasing. So I'm broadcasting here from this 5,000 square foot demo center that we assembled in our Chicago branch. The other side of the wall, just the other side over here, is a 100,000 square foot distribution facility, stock floor to ceiling with all the substrates, inks, medias, things that you need to run a print business. When we built this demo center here, the initial thought was like, oh yeah, you know, we're centrally located in Chicago, so it's easy for anybody in the United States to get to this location to come see equipment and everything else. But the thought was, maybe down in the future, we'll get some cameras where, you know, if a customer doesn't want to travel, we can log in remotely. With this COVID quarantine situation we found ourselves in, this has been our main means of communication the last 2 months, and it's been a phenomenal opportunity to keep bringing these virtual events to you guys. So with us today, we have the ESKO Kongsberg flatbed cutting table. So we're going to run through. I don't want to waste any more time with introductions. We've got a lot of material we want to run through and cut on this table to kind of show you guys the features and function of this machine and how it can work for you. So let me go ahead and jump right into it. The first material I'm going to cut today is some O3O magnet. So it's a really thick, heavy magnet, not a thin self-adhesive vinyl. But I'm doing a print and cut workflow on this one. So using the Onyx software and then ripping it over to my HP flatbed cutter, flatbed printer, I printed direct onto this magnet with my registration marks, my barcode label on there. So I'm going to go ahead and set this down at my table and take the machine through the print and cut workflow. There we are.
So are you sharing your screen?
I'm not going to show screen now.
So we're able to go through, find our registration marks. Machine will come down, touch, figure out thickness of the material. We'll use that as the reference for our cutting profile. So here we can see we're using a rigid material knife, which allows us to cut substrates up to 5 millimeter thick, anything from paper to magnet to expanded PVC, or any of our coroplast, any other rigid substrates or thin substrates that we have. We have a number of different blades that can actually go into this particular tool, which kind of turns into a Swiss Army knife.
And there we have it all set up. So the part that Ramon was talking about, using the different blades on this one, this magnet material tends to want to stick to itself. And so by using the blade on this tool, I'll actually take a quick moment to pull it out of here. The blade on this tool has a little thicker of a profile to it. There we are. So it's got a little thicker of a profile to it, so it acts kind of like a snowplow. And when that magnet material wants to stick back on itself, it kind of shoves it apart to make a nice clean cut around this. So in just a quick moment, let me hold the sample right side up. Nice clean cut, rounded corners on there, nice and clean. So the same tooling, the through cut knife, could be used for contour cut decals as well. Magnet is a trickier material to cut, so I thought it'd be nice to start out with a difficult one right off the bat. Let me go ahead and reinsert this tool back in there.
The really nice thing about our tool setups is, as you can see, how easy it is to pop that back in. We have a unique barcode on each individual tool that when we insert the tool and identify it, it's able to scan that barcode to know what tool it is and what position it's in. For this particular model, we've got, this is what we call our multi-cut head, which allows two different tool inserts along with the router in the rightmost position.
So the next example I want to get into cutting is I want to demonstrate the milling unit on this machine, the routing unit. To do that, I'm going to put on this sacrificial mat. So when I'm using the knife that I just cut, I'm cutting right to the zero depth of this belt that's on here. And it does cut slightly into the belt, but the belt is meant to take that knife edge, you know, on a very minute level. That knife blade cuts right into that belt just a little bit. But milling, you're going significantly deeper to get all the way through the material to get a nice clean edge on any material you're going to route out. So to do that, I throw on this sacrificial mat to do any of my routing. Set this down here. So, go ahead.
I was going to say, so anytime we lay a sacrificial mat down, we do what's called a tabletop reference. And the tabletop reference gives us that do not pass go mark so that, you know, we won't go through the sacrificial mat. We do this when we put a sac mat on, we do when we do a sac mat off.
So just for demonstration purposes, I'm going to go ahead and release the bit that's currently in here. But if I was going to route different materials, you're going to use a specific bit based on the material. For this one, I'm going to use this exact same bit. So this is a coated bit, has a slight, like a heat treat shimmer to it. This is the bit I'm going to use. I'm going to route out a piece of max metal, some ACM. So it's a thin skin of aluminum with some PVC in the middle and then another thin skin of aluminum. And so the coated bit gives me a nice clean cut through that ACM. So I'm going to reinsert this in here. And anytime you're replacing a bit or a blade, you want to touch off to get an accurate measurement of that tool. And so I'm using the X-Pad device, which allows me to get a really precise measurement of that bit. You know, I set that bit inside that chuck by hand. You know, I'm pretty sure I didn't put it in the exact same way every single time, so I want to get a measurement of that tool. So I'm going to share my screen with you guys real quick so you can see what it's doing on the screen, and hopefully you will see a thumbnail of what the X-Pad is doing. So here we go. So I hit a nice quick easy button down here at the bottom of my panel for measure tool. I'm going to select the milling tool, measure tool, and then it's a matter of placing my laser beam right over that X-Pad device. It's going to touch off with the green foot and then move that milling tool over that X-Pad and touch off and get an exact measurement of the depth of that bit as I placed it in there. So you saw me remove my rigid material knife. I didn't change the blade though, so it knows what the depth of that blade is. So only when I change the bit or the blade, do I need to go through this touch off process. So it's something you'll use every time you change out your pad to get it, or change out your bit or blade, but not every time you change from different tooling configurations, so long as you keep that bit or the blade the exact same. All right.
So now we've got our max metal down. We're going to drop our vacuum foot. That's our debris vacuum hose. So then that way that removes all of the debris as we go through and we do a routing. We have a lot of customers that ask questions about sensitivity of dust and how much dust is generated. When we actually go through and do all this, we have a couple of different ways we can do it, but we remove all of the dust as we go through and cut.
There we have it. So that ACM is routed or milled in a one-pass configuration. Little dust and debris chips on here, but as far as a clean edge, nice clean edge. The PVC doesn't have any chattering in it, which means I cut it at the right speed, feed and speed of the bit itself. So you don't need to follow up and do any deburring afterwards. So really, really nice, nice clean edge, better than a factory cut edge. And so that was just a cut workflow. There was no print layer added to it, but you certainly can do a print and cut workflow. We cut these circles out of space, ACM as well. You can see a nice clean edge that you get on there. No chattery edge to the PVC. Your aluminum's nice and clean as well. This is kind of a neat tool or a bit that I use frequently with ACM or with Max Metal. It's a angle corner bit, which allows me to do, so this is a print and cut workflow. I printed the direct onto the Max Metal using the HP series, and then I applied my cut layer to the backside and was able to cut in a groove, a V-groove into this here, V-groove into the corners, so it allows me to fold up my ACM, put some epoxy in there to make that a solid corner, and now instead of just a flat sign on a wall, I have some depth to this sign that really kind of makes it stand out and adds a tremendous amount of value to this material. So let me go ahead and clear off this extra mat. Thank you. The next piece I want to show is just cutting corrugated, and I'll share my screen with you guys to see the cut layer that goes involved in this one.
We can also see how fast we can do a tabletop reference to go between our different substrates.
All right.
So now that we've taken our sacrificial mat off, we'll be able to do a tabletop reference to bring all of our tools loaded and unloaded down to the proper height.
There you go. And it's just a simple matter of clicking this button here. Now the sacrificial mat is removed, touches off, we're good to go. Jump into this file here. So I have two layers in here. I use my material presets as well as my tooling preset here to choose the appropriate cutting method. So I have my registration layer, which is indicated by these marks here, as well as my cut layer. It's applying the RM knife and using this. If you wanted to change, these tooling presets, we know, hey, this works great on this material. We're going to stick with it all the time. But something comes along and you say, hey, I want to try using a different tooling configuration. It's a simple matter of going through here, selecting the different parameters. Say you want to slow it down for some reason or add an overcut onto it. It's a simple matter of going through here, hitting OK. You can either create a new tooling preset or just update the existing tooling preset. From here, I'm going to go ahead and hit cut. It wants to find that first registration mark, so I'm going to manually put it over there, over the first registration layer. So down here on my production screen, it's telling me, hey, put the camera over this first mark. I'm over that first mark. I confirm that it's there. It finds that first one, finds the second, and now it's going to go all the way through the process.
Another benefit of the rigid material knife is you can see that we didn't change our blade or anything, but going from what we cut first to coroplast, we could go straight to folding carton, we could go to expanding the PVC, all without changing the blade. It really does become a very versatile material.
There we have it. Because it used that registration layer, as soon as I found it, it gave me precise, exact square cuts.
Repeatability is good.
There we are. And there we have it. So perfectly cut corners on a coro, nice smooth edges. Pulls it right on through. So the one thing, I don't know if you guys noticed, there's a vacuum on the table itself that's holding that coro in place. So it lets that knife push its way through that material without shifting the material around on you. All right, there we go. So the next piece I want to demonstrate for you is simple vinyl. Again, this is a print and cut combination, just cutting through some, I think this is a Brightline 3201. I'm sorry, 3203, the gloss vinyl. What I want to do is do a tool change. So right now with the three tools, I have my milling tool, I have my rigid material knife, and then in my tooling position one, I have my high frequency knife. This material doesn't need a high frequency. What I want to use on this is a kiss cut tool. So just like a traditional plotter, this kiss cut blade, there we are, that's you. This kiss cut blade, a really, really fine tipped, small detailed blade on there to even get that to focus. So really, really small blade with a spring-loaded touch-off pad that has adjustability at the top of it. So this lets me dial in for different thicknesses. So this is an unlaminated, fairly thin self-adhesive vinyl. If I had a laminated thick, like a floor film with a thick floor lam on there, you're talking an almost 10 mil combination of materials. I'll just a quick little adjustment to the depth and pressure of my blade, and it'll cut through just fine. Doing a kiss cut followed with a through cut. And that's the beauty of the multiple knife options. I'm going to do a kiss cut with a kiss cut blade and then follow up and do a through cut with the other blade. So I'm going to swap once again and show you my screen to show you the workflow we got going on here. So I have three layers on this file. So I have my registration mark layer, which is indicated with black, the little black registration dots on the outside. My kiss cut or contour cut layer is applied with a kiss cut layer. So it's going to use that correct tool for it and then follow through with the red outline of a through cut. So this will give me where I can weed away this excess vinyl and then go through it. And all of that was set by just selecting this tooling preset. It set all those parameters for me. So it wasn't something I had to skip the step. I switched out tools. So I need to click this tool identifier. And what it's going to do is spin those tools around, know what tools are loaded there, and now I'm ready for production. Again, find that first registration mark, confirm that I'm on it. There we are. So that kiss cut knife is going through and doing the contour cut circle around the Grimco logo. And now it's going to drop right into that through cut layer and give me those individual Grimco logos cut out into the separate squares. So obviously I printed these at a pretty large 20-inch circles or so, but the same velocities would apply if you're doing something much smaller. You're doing just some decals that you wanted to be able to stack up and send to a customer. You can do much smaller and obviously much larger as well too. So the overall cutting size of this table that we have in here in front of us, the Kongsberg, is 60 by 120. There's a bunch of different table combinations. We're going to share a slide with you guys a little later that kind of goes into some of that, as well as all of the features that we're showing you here.
I would say this is probably our most common configuration that we typically have. This would be an X24 combination, which we'll get into later on.
But all the tooling and options and things that we're going through with you two, a lot of that is all customizable as well. The table I have behind me is a conveyor belt option. To me, it doesn't seem like it's optional because it's so nice to use that conveyor belt. But there's a bunch of different features and options. So now I'm able to remove my vinyl, and I have a nice 24-inch kiss cut or contour cut sticker. Get rid of my vinyl. We're good to go. All right.
Yeah, the real versatility with this table kind of goes from all the different ways that we've actually been able to demonstrate the substrates we're doing. So, you know, going from a coroplast to an ACM to a vinyl with only one tool change at this point. So the next material we have here appears to be foam board. So are we going to change tools for this?
I'll change the tool, put it back in there.
Kind of show how, actually, can you slide it over there to that camera? That might be easier for them to see how easy it is to swap out the tools.
This up a little bit.
As I can do the Vanna White thing for you here.
There we are. Let me pull this one out. Hand that over to you.
Swap those guys. There you go.
Thank you.
So we've got the large black handle that is spring-loaded to help actually lock that tool in place. So we can just depress that black handle and then lift the tool out.
And this is a powered, there's a motor that drives this unit. Sorry for the shakiness there. And so I'll, once I get the tool inserted, plug it in here, and that's going to control that oscillation of that blade tip as it cuts through my foam board. You know, cutting through foam board with a static knife, any dullness or edge on that static knife as you're dragging through can sometimes tear your foam board. And so using this oscillating knife, it helps it make its way through that foam board and give you a nice clean cut. So once again, I'll share my screen here. And here's our foam board sign. So all of these files I've already pulled up and kind of set my parameters for you. But I am going to take one. Then the next piece I'm going to cut, I'll take you through the actual process of opening the file just to show you how intuitive and easy it is to work through these. But this is a realistic workflow. You know, you're cutting one job right now, but you know your next 4 or 7 jobs that you got to cut on this table. Go ahead and pull those files up already, get them ready to go. You don't need to wait until the material is on your table to start setting your parameters. But in this one, I'm using this Gilman Insight Reveal as the material. I already have a tooling preset already queued up for it. There's my registration layer, and it's using my high frequency knife to do the cutting. So go into production from here. Oops, again. I got to do the tool change, recognize my tool change, and now we're ready to send it into production. So again, go over that first registration mark. It's telling me right here, zoom in on that for you. It's saying, hey, find this registration mark first. So I just move my camera over that section. That's the mark. Confirm that I'm on the right section. Knows where the next mark is, goes right to it. You can hear that motor engage a little bit. It's oscillating that blade as it's cutting through my foam board. Allows it to run it at full speed and get a nice clean cut through that foam board.
Now, we also actually have a couple of different ways that we could produce a file. Everything we've been doing so far has been from the top side. And for some of our customers in the packaging world, we may not have that option with a direct print, where we might actually have to produce the job from the back side. Do you want to talk about the flip and cut capability that we have?
Absolutely. So I'm actually going to demonstrate that on the next piece that we cut. The flip and cut capability is phenomenal on this machine. So I'll pull these off, give you guys a close-up view in the camera here. So nice clean cuts. Here's my corner pieces right here. Nice clean edges to all of them. Perfect registration. You got nice and even reveal around this foam board. Quick and easy way of grouping up jobs. So let's jump into that flip and cut. One of the neat features of this machine. So again, this is a print and cut workflow. This job, the print files for this job, or the print and cut files for this job, were set up in the iCut layout. I'll share a quick screen with that, and then we'll show you everything we got to do for the flip and cut process. So here is the iCut layout display. Similar image. This is just a representation of it, but it nests and groups all of your images as well as your cut files, so you can maximize your material width. You can get the most amount of print and cut out of the same area. So the file I have in front of me has these guitars. Let me jump over and open this file for you. File open. Here's my PVC guitars. So all of those guitars were nested nicely. I'm going to rotate it to match up with what my table is. And then it's a simple matter of going through here, choosing what material I'm using. And so this is a PVC, Palram PVC. So all of these substrates that I've used today, so the corrugated that we have here, the foam board that we used on here, the Gilman Insight Reveal, all of these substrates and things that we're chopping through, all available at grimco.com. They're all the standard materials that we use to produce all the signage and graphics that we use. So Palram PVC is the material I'm cutting here. I already have a tooling preset already set for it, so it recognized it, applied the correct tooling. The only thing I'm going to do different is over here, I'm going to apply this operation to the back side. And so when it goes through that print and cut registration process, it's now going to incorporate the corners and registration marks. So if I drop down this box, it's going to find one corner as well as the edge, and I want it to recognize the edge. We're going to go 24 inches. This piece was cut down from a 4x8 sheet. So I'm going to register 24 inches up the one edge and then go ahead and send it to it. One thing I want to check is my direction of the flip. Okay, so we're going to flip it on an X axis. So you can do either one, an X or a Y, based on the size of the sheet, how you're going to flip it. Let's go ahead and send this into production. Okay, so it's telling me I need to get a valid background, so now it knows what my, go ahead and do that again and get off here. It knows what the table looks like, the belt is going to look like. So now I just need to get it over to the corner of the material, and that green box is saying, hey, I recognize this as a corner. All I have to do is confirm that. And now the machine is going to go through the process of finding that corner and then finding that edge. It extrapolates that edge out to 24 inches. Now it knows where all that is. Now it's asking me to direct it to the first registration point, which is right here in the guitar. So I'm going to jog my camera over and make sure I'm in that first registration mark, confirm it. I'm going to go through and find all the other registration marks in this file. It disengages that vacuum, and it tells me to flip my material over in the X-axis. So I flip my material over, confirm that action, and now it needs to find that same corner and same edge that it sought out before. I jog my camera back over to that corner, confirm, hey, I'm on that corner. And then it goes through the cutting process. So the perfect application for this process that we're doing right now, this blind cut or flip and cut process, you can apply it with any tool. It doesn't need to just be the RM knife. It could be your milling unit. So if you mounted some self-adhesive vinyl to the top side of acrylic or a piece of max metal, and you're worried about that milling unit, the upcut nature of that bit, of pulling the edges of your self-adhesive vinyl away from your substrate, you do a flip and cut, and now that upcut bit is going to pull your vinyl into the edge of your material, and you're not going to have any dangly vinyl on the other side. It's also very, very useful for print and cut corrugated packaging. You know, you run a sheet of corrugated cardboard through your R-series with a print and cut layer on one side, but you want to put creases or folds to it. You want to do all that folding application on the backside so that your printed image stays on the outside of the packaging. There's actually some really neat tools I want to share with you that are designed specifically for cutting packaging. So this is a crease wheel tool. So this crease wheel pops off. I feed that into my machine, have it loaded up in one position, and then I take this in the other position, and this is a Coro speed tool. And so what that's going to do is, as the knife wants to cut, this rounded dome side is going to crush down that corrugated to make it nice and flat, so you get a nice clean cut on the corrugated. Here's another kind of neat tool that's good for some kind of packaging and POP display designs. It's a 45-degree rigid knife. So if I wanted to fold up to make
structural design,
thicker, tables. Like one inch thick corrugated sheets. You can cut a 45, or you cut two 45s, and then you can fold that up into a 90 degree fold, and build some structure out of your materials. I'm sorry, I'll hand these out to you as well. But so using this this reverse blind print and cut, it allows you to do that. I really hope everything lines up. This is the big reveal. Looks like everything went perfectly. So here's my perfect cut blind. Here was all my registration marks. Let's show you some of the guitars that we chopped out here. And we have perfect reveal. You know, so in this application, I know this isn't going to show well on camera, but this is the side that we were cutting on. Let's see if it You can see there's a slight overcut just based on the nature. That blade has a slight bend to it. So when it was cutting, that blade went into this material just a little bit. But on my printed side, in the tight corner, you see no overcut at all, because that this is where the bottom side of that blade was as it went through. So there's no overcut at all on here. It'll give you perfect registration, even though it was doing it to the reverse side of the material, or reverse side of the print. All right. So I talked about earlier, this table has the conveyor belt. And to me, it's one of the neatest features of this. I can't really show you the feed system in the back. There's a nice well-built roller system. I have some banner material that I put on here. The nice thing about this roller system, I'm printing on some 13-ounce Duratex banner. Those rolls can get kind of heavy. So I ran an entire roll on my printer. This is on the Epson S series. So it burned through. The Epson S series prints so fast. I ran through a whole roll of material. I don't want to have to carry that physical roll over here. So I can take my carriage over to my printer, feed it right up on there, and then just roll my carriage right to my cutting table. So it makes for a really nice workflow, not having to lug, printed rolls of material all the way around your shop. So I'm back here on the feed. I got my material all set up here. I'm just going to set it down onto my table. And then Ramon's going to help me out and engage the drop-down carriage, and it'll pull that banner material all the way forward. Perfect. Thank you. So let me share my screen with you guys again. All of these files that we were cutting so far today had a barcode or a QR code to find the file, rather than me having to dig through a whole pile of files to look for. So I'm going to show you how that barcode system works. So I'm going to open a file via barcode. So all of the machines that we have here in the demo center can print to this barcode server. They communicate and send the cut data over to my ESKO Kongsberg. So I'm going to access that real quick. Set my camera over the barcode and let it know, hey, that's the barcode I want you to cut and find. And here we are. And so now it recognized, hey, this is 13 ounce material, but it didn't apply a tooling preset. So it's just a quick matter of me going through here, choosing my tooling preset that I want to apply. We'll do banner trimming. And so it takes both of these. One of these files, I printed two different banners here. One had the cut contour already set in the file. And then the other one was a tile outline, which my Onyx RIP software generated this tile outline. So it's an unknown layer type. I could just quickly go through here and tell it, hey, cut, but it already applied the correct tooling preset, using the correct knife with that speed, the correct knife with the same speed. So we're good to go. Just a quick matter, jump over to production, and there we go, and we're set. So we're going to go ahead and skip cutting the banner material, but the nice thing about this is when I'm done cutting these sets of banners, I can roll that barcode forward. I have a nice catch basket on my machine here. Roll this catch basket into place when I'm doing a full production run. I got, an entire roll of banner material, and it can just automatically move forward, feed it, get this material off my table, grab that next barcode, go into that cutting process, keep doing that for the entire roll. And there is a very simple system to set that up automatically where it goes on a roll feed system. Really easy to kind of work through entire rolls of material. I don't want to say set it and forget it. You may want to be near the table while it's doing that cutting process, but it does kind of improve your workflow. You're not having to dig around and find files quickly. Quick second, check a couple tabs, hit your tooling preset, and then it goes right into cutting. So Ramon, you got anything you feel like we breezed over, you skipped before we throw it to the moderators on the channel for any questions that came up?
The different lines that we have. So we actually have two different lines of machines that work within a production or a prototyping standpoint, and also budgetary standpoints. So we, looking at this, we can kind of see our production versus cost kind of scale. And we basically have a table for, I would say, probably every budget and demographic. So we have our entry tables or our starter tables, which are good for being able to work with a customer trying to get their foot in the door. So we've got what we call our edge series, which is we have our X tables and our C tables. So our X tables are our prototyping sample making tables, And then our C tables are production mainline tables. So we basically have a table that'll cut at 1,000 inches a minute, one that'll cut at 2,000 inches a minute, one that'll do 3,000, and then one at 4,000. So the top dog that we see up in the upper right corner there is going to be our full-blown Kongsberg C. That's a full wide format 10 by 10 or 126 by 126 inch workspace table. For wide format, super wide format, we can do automation with it. And the all of our tables are modular. So the we're able to run the same software, the same tooling setups. So all of the tables are the same. It really just comes down to a speed point.
Cool. Well, thanks for that. So as you can see, there's lots of options available to you, and it's finding that right solution. So any questions? I mean, we did a grand broad paintbrush overview of the machine today. I wanted to show you some of the neat capabilities of it. But obviously, if you're interested and you want to pursue things further, reach out to your local Grimco hardware specialist. We can get the ESKO team involved in it. It's the unlimited options available with this machine. It's not just, I'll take that model, we're good to go. Maybe for some people it is, but you want to make sure you're getting the right tooling for it and then know what your options are in the future to add on to expand your capabilities. We're good. And so here is the Grimco number. Feel free to reach out to us. If anybody wants one of these magnets to put on their fridge in their shop, just let me know and I'll make sure I get one to you. On the line with us, I'm going to throw it over to Dave Ahouse and Dustin and see if they got some questions and answers that popped up during the chat that they might have covered.
I think one question that we can go over a little more in depth is what are the workflow options and or capabilities on this unit, more on the software side, not on the equipment side.
Is that to me?
Did you hear?
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yes.
So as far as workflows for pre-press or automation or both?
I would say primarily for automation, but a little bit for pre-press also.
Okay, so we have one of the things we kind of talked about real quick was our layout software. That's part of our iCut suite. And that gives us the ability for true shape nesting. That gives us the ability to process banners and storefronts. There's a lot of different solutions we have that we can do for that as far as graphic prep. We work in conjunction with that to be able to, you know, like this example we're looking at right here. Screen.
Sorry.
Okay. Nope. Okay, that'll work. So this we can actually see. This is set up for our banner setup. So our software is actually smart enough to be able to go through. This would be a two-sided graphic because we can actually see where the edges on your top, your bottom, your left, and your right, where they would actually be able to fold and line up with the graphic that's on the back. So all of that is done automatically through the software. So we can pick and choose what we want. For this particular setup, we can pick and choose what we want on the front side, what we want on the back side, how big our hem is going to be, if we're going to add grommets or not. It does it all automatically, and then it allows us to export a file directly to the table and the print to the printer, or to the RIP software, I should say. In the other one, so here we talk about true shape nesting. So with this, we were able to enter 1, 2, 3, 4 different graphics and nest them for, we can do it for a minimum layout, we can do it for minimum waste. This was probably set up for a minimum layout, which allows us to do an overrun or print extras. So with this, we have kind of that nesting capability where we can also tie in with our automation software as well. Now, our automation software, which we don't really have a screen grab of, we have a ton of software solutions for that. So we talk about how this would work into that. We actually have our automation software is called Automation Engine, and it is a ton of different modules that allow us to do a ton of different things. So in a standard kind of quick, I guess, simple workflow, we would be able to have customers upload an image, pick a size, that size would automatically fill a sheet, automatically fill a graphic, and then when the board is full, be able to print the board and then have it come to the table with a generated cut file to be able to cut and send out.
Ramon, the one thing I get it pulled up on the screen right now, the different production methods. So you're doing your roll feed, multi-zone production. Want to talk about that for a moment?
Sure. So within IPC or iCut Production Console, the software that actually runs with the table, we have a number of different ways that we can actually process the materials we're looking to cut. So in looking on here, right now we've got park after table. That's our most standard. I'm going to cut a one up kind of mode, which means it's going to produce the table. And once it's done with the table, it's going to park afterwards. In the list, we also have the capability for manual sheet feeding, which would, if we had a table at the back, we would be able to use the conveyor belt to go back, grab that sheet if somebody is manually holding it. We also have multi-zone production, which allows us to break the table in half. So if I were working in this case with 4x4 sheets on this table, I would be able to cut the job on the front half of the table with the vacuum in the back half of the table being off, so I could load or unload and then hit go. And when it's done with the front half of the table, it'll go to the back and then vice versa. You basically just flip and fold between, or flip and, well, I guess over the traverse as you're doing the front and the back, front and the back, front and the back.
And this is that's one of the nice signs when you have you're trying to clear your table and it's going to take you a few minutes to move your material off the table to collect your pieces off of there. It's a nice way to set that workflow up. So you know, your table's always cutting and you keep moving forward with production. Without this option, your table would have to sit parked while you're pulling your pieces off and then you set it in action. But this one, the table can kind of keep going all day as you bounce from the front side of your table to your back side of your table.
It definitely keeps you busy.
Yeah, it's a fun dance.
Yeah, it's definitely dancing. And then we have our park after table manual vacuum. If we were going to manually turn off the vacuum, and then park after table normal, where it automatically shuts the vacuum off for you.
Yep. That answer some of the questions, Dave?
Absolutely. Next question is, so in demos, we always do these fun shapes like the guitars, but we also know in production, that is
not a lot of customers order guitars,
right? Like 90% of the stuff is still rectangles, which of course one could do with a straight edge and a razor blade. So kind of walk through time-wise, how much quicker and also error factor, doesn't make an error. It is better than just doing it manually where you have somebody with a razor blade and hopefully not cutting off their fingers.
Right. Yeah, correct. And it's one of those, you know, I've definitely spent my plenty of time over a cutting mat with a straight edge for hours at end, and it's fatigue of your employees. And the nice thing too, yeah, granted, most of your cuts may just be square straight cuts. It's having those workflows where you throw it on the table, it's cut in a minute, and you're done. You're moving on. You get a perfect cut 100% of the time. The really nice thing is work with your customers to try to do that more value added. Everything looks better with a nice little crop corner. You know, these magnets don't show it real well, but you know, you cannot really stick a magnet on the side of a vehicle with square corners. It's more likely to catch the wind. Whereas you get a rounded corner on there, it's going to be, you know, kind of lets the air go over that side of that magnet a little better. You know, PVC shapes, you know, the best, all your competitors are offering square cut, and you're able to offer a contour cut, even if it's just rounded corners. Rounded corner signs look so much better than just square cut signs.
I would say another nice thing is we do have optimization capability within the file. So like, for instance, the Coroplast file that we had, we're used to kind of seeing you cut out a rectangle starting at one corner and then just going around the shape and then going to the next one and going around the shape. We have an optimization file where we can go through and go from a standard rectangle to just a straight guillotine cut. And we've seen time changes depending on how many rectangles or squares are you're putting up on a single sheet. I think that the biggest change I've seen has been like 20 minutes. If we were talking like a full 4x8 sheet of business cards or something like that. Does that kind of answer your question?
Could you talk a little bit about the fabric cutting options available?
Thanks for bringing that up. I spaced on it. It's one of my favorite tools of this machine. So the ESKO has, it's called a rotocut tool.
You're kind of breaking up a little bit.
Okay, moving on. So the rotocut tool. So again, it's a powered head. I'm holding it upside down. So there's a motor inside here. It plugs into my cutting head. It has this glide shoe over it. Let's remove this here. And it's got a rotary knife that spins. So this motor is going to drive that spinning knife. The nice thing is the glide shoe is going to hold your material down. You know, most, you're going to be cutting fabric on this. The vacuum is not going to work really well to hold most fabric down because it's porous. The glide shoe holds that down and lets that rotary knife pop out and does a nice straight cut. of your fabric. So it's not a knife dragging through fabric, it's a spinning blade going through your fabric.
Kind of helps avoid that wave that can sometimes occur in front of a blade.
There's another tool I want to show you guys as well, that didn't make the cut for the demo today, but it's definitely a valuable knife that solves a lot of cutting solutions. It's called the Silligraphy Knife. And real quick, here's that barcode reader. So every time I change out tools in my head and I hit identify tools, it spins that tool, reads that barcode, and it knows what tool is in there. So this tool is called my Silligraphy Knife. And it's basically a drag knife. You know, it's going to drag behind. It's got a nice tipped blade on there. But the beauty of it is this Teflon shoe that goes over the top. And just like the rotary knife, it's going to apply pressure to the material and to expose that knife blade on there and to allow you to get a nice clean cut and a super fine detailed cut. So if you're doing those really detailed contour cut stickers, and you're through cutting, you're cutting through your vinyl as well as your backer paper, this knife works really, really well.
Yeah, we've even got some customers that do like almost lace work in folding carton with those.
With that, yeah.
It's pretty slick.
Yeah, it allows you to get some really intricate detail cuts because it's putting pressure on that material at the same time it's dragging the blade through there and cutting.
Can we also talk a little bit about the router spindle/milling options that are available?
Sure. So there are two routers that are available. The router that we have on this machine is our 1 kilowatt 45,000 RPM air-cooled router. The other router that we have would be a 3 kilowatt 60,000 RPM liquid-cooled router. And we have the same capability with both machines, but we tend to find the 3 kilowatt more in a production environment as the whole liquid-cooled setup actually works a little bit better for longer durability. That kind of answer your question, or are you looking for some other stuff?
I think okay. And then one other question that somebody else has had is, obviously the thing that makes the most noise on this unit is not the milling/spindle, but rather the blower or vacuum. Do you guys have that in the room? Have you and any suggestions on how to reduce that noise and what folks can do?
Yeah, absolutely. So on this unit, we have it. It's literally directly in the corner there. There's a stop-back dust collection and then the actual blower unit for the device itself. That entire thing can be set up in another section of room to make it a little quieter. I'm always a big fan of numbers, Dave. I think you know that by now. And so when we had this unit set up here and I'm running some jobs, I have a nice sound meter because I wanted to know how, you know, I was milling some really thick cast acrylic and I wanted to know how loud it was. And so I held out my little decibel sound meter reader and we never exceeded, even at running a faster speed, which makes the milling unit work a little harder, never really exceeded about 75 decibels. So it was definitely a safe sound inside here. But yeah, if you wanted to have as quiet as possible and maybe the quiet would be the new, you can mount that entire section somewhere else and or route it up in through your ceiling. It's completely, it can be moved separate of the table. Or if you were tight on space to be able to fit your table into a certain space, you can extend that unit out elsewhere to accommodate the things that drive it.
We also do have a sound enclosure box that can go over it that has its own internal fan to help maintain temperature that allows us to carry a standard, I would say a standard volume conversation even over it while it's running. That's what we typically have at trade shows. So I would say to answer that question, the loudest noise you're gonna hear is gonna be the wind rushing out of it. So even in this environment where it is right now, it's really not bad. Like you said, it was like 70, 75 decibels. The sound enclosure would probably drop that down to like 50, 55 if I had to guess. And then beyond that, yeah, you would potentially put it into another room or up above the ceiling. We've had a lot of customers do different solutions.
All right. Well, it sounds like we're good. Thanks, Dave and Dustin, for answering the calls on the or answering the questions on the fly. That was phenomenal. I hope everybody got something good out of this presentation. We're super glad to be bringing these content to you guys on a regular basis. Just so you know, there is talks and plans. We're going to continue to bring these virtual events to you. I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, but there's a lot of cool things on the horizon that we're going to continue to offer here out of the demo center. If you have any questions, you want to do a follow-up demo, you got a couple other, you know, more detailed questions that we didn't cover in this thing, reach out to your Grimco sales rep, let us know, hey, you know, that guy Neil in the demo center, he did an awesome job. I want to talk to him some more. So we'll have a cup of coffee. It'll be good. So we'll thank everybody for attending this morning, and we'll see you in the future.